I'm Michael Roland from the NFC Research Lab in Hagenberg, which is a department, research department of the Upper Austria University of Applied Sciences. I will show you today how to clone contactless credit cards. So, short outline of my presentation. First, I will give an introduction to the EMV contactless standard and to MasterCard papers, which is an implementation of the EMV contactless standard. And then I will show how to prepay and downgrade these contactless credit cards to get them to work at an actual point of sales terminal. And if we have enough time, I will give a short demonstration video. Unfortunately, I couldn't do a live demo today because I couldn't bring a point of sale terminal with me. So what is EMV contactless? To you in the US, it might be some strange thing. You in the US usually use magnetic stripe cards. In Europe, we moved to chip-based credit cards. In the US, it's slowly starting now to move to chip-based credit cards. So EMV contactless is the contactless version of this chip-based credit card. It's so the credit card has the chip interface and additional an antenna interface. It's based on ISO 14443 proximity protocol. It uses inductive coupling at 13.56 megahertz, which makes it compatible to NFC, NFC technology, which is typically embedded in newer smartphones. So the EMV contactless standard is actually not one single standard, but it's a conglomerate out of several different proprietary payment systems, or kind of proprietary payment systems, that different payment card schemes implemented based on the contact EMV standard. So for example, we have Amex Express Pay, which is reflected in EMV contactless kernel 4. We have JCB's Chase Speedy, which is reflected in kernel 1 and the new kernel 5. We have MasterCard Papers, which is kernel 2. And we have Visa PayWave, which is kernel 1 and kernel 3. So my talk today focuses on kernel 2, the MasterCard Papers protocol. MasterCard Papers has two operating modes, EMV mode, the more secure mode, and MagStripe mode, legacy mode, to magnetic stripe system. So in EMV mode, the secure chip uses the EMV protocol, just like it uses it over the contact interface, so this is the chip and pin. And MagStripe mode also uses the secure chip, but the secure chip emulates the magnetic stripe system. So basically, it contains similar data to the magnetic stripe on the back of the card. This makes it compatible to magnetic stripe backend systems. So what's the state of support of these two, the EMV mode and the MagStripe mode? MagStripe mode is mandatory for all MasterCard Papers cards and all MasterCard Papers terminals. EMV mode is optional, but except for Europe, where in Europe both modes are mandatory. So if you get a card in Europe, it will support both MagStripe mode for compatibility and EMV mode for security. Same with terminals. Terminals in Europe support both MagStripe mode and EMV mode. So how does kernel 2's EMV mode work? The card contains static card data, for instance, the primary account number, the expiry date, etc. And an issuer's digital signature over the static data, so that the correctness of the static data can, or the integrity of the static data can be verified offline. Then it contains public keys of the card issuer and the card itself. And the chip also contains a secret key of the card for generating digital signatures. The transaction works by terminal reads the card data, so static card data. Then the terminal authenticates the card using the issuer's digital signature. And in the last step, the terminal sends the payment transaction data to the card, and the card authenticates the payment transaction data by generating a digital signature over this data. MagStripe mode is clearly simpler. Card contains, again, static card data, in a format comparable to that on the magnetic stripe of the card. And it contains a secret key for generating a dynamic card verification code. In a transaction, the terminal again reads the card data. Then the terminal sends an unpredictable number, a challenge, to the card, and the card generates a dynamic card verification code for this challenge. So the terminal can, or the card authenticates itself, but not the card, not the transaction data. So not the amount of the transaction, etc. And this card verification code can then later be used by the card issuer to verify that a transaction was actually performed with a real credit card. So the main difference is to EMV mode that there is no offline authentication of the static card data, so there is no digital signature of this static card data, and there is no authentication of the payment of the transaction data itself. So what's the goal of our attack? We want to skim contactless credit cards, so we want to create a clone of a credit card, and we want to use this clone at a contactless point of sale terminal. So we want to actually, so we want the terminal to actually accept our copied contactless credit card. And we target kernel 2's MagStripe mode, which is supported by all cards and all terminals. So why did we choose MagStripe mode? MagStripe mode is pretty simple. Most of the card data is static and can be skimmed. And the terminal cannot check the integrity of this static data. The only problem with MagStripe mode is that there is this dynamic card verification code, which should protect the card from being copied. So this is used as a proof that the terminal actually communicated with the original card. How do existing attacks avoid this CVC3, so the dynamic card verification code? They simply don't copy it, they simply don't use it, and use the card data, the static card data, only with merchants that do not require this card verification code, for example, online merchants like Amazon. So how does this card verification code work? Card verification code is a function of an unpredictable number, the challenge of the terminal, transaction counter, and the secret card key. So a secret card key is securely stored on the card and cannot be skimmed, and it protects against generation of CVCs without the original card. Transaction counter is stored on the card and incremented for every transaction, so it protects the card or the CVCs against reuse, replay attacks, and it protects against, or it should protect against out-of-sequence use of CVC codes. So if you have a series of CVC codes, they're all associated with one transaction counter, and you cannot use, or you should not be able to use, an older CVC code after a newer one was used. And the unpredictable number is the challenge generated by the terminal. This should protect against pre-generation of CVCs. So an attacker should not be able to generate a series of CVC codes and later present them to the terminal. So why is a preplay attack possible despite this CVC code, which is supposed to protect against preplay attacks? Well, the preplay attack, or the preplay protection, relies on the unpredictable number. And if this unpredictable number becomes predictable for the attacker, then the attacker can also pre-generate specific CVC codes to simulate a real card. So how does the unpredictable number in EMV contactless kernel 2 work? Well, the unpredictable number is a 4-byte field, so it is about 4.3 billion possible values, which makes pre-generation pretty unfeasible. But this field is limited to a BCD encoding, which means that the bytes represented as hexadecimal digits actually contain only decimal digits, which reduces the range to about 100 million possible values, quite a lot less than the original or the whole range of possible values, but still pre-generation of 100 million values is definitely unfeasible. However, this number of BCD digits that's actually used in this 4-byte value is defined by the card issuer and is stored on the card. Typical cards like this credit card use 2 to 3 digits. 3 digits means only 1,000 possible values. 1,000 possible values, pre-generation is feasible, so we can perform a pre-play attack. Why did they use such a low limit for the digits? Well, to be compatible to the MaxStripe backend system, they have only a certain number of digits available in this MaxStripe data that can be sent over the MasterCard network, which makes it possible to do more than 3 digits, but not a lot more of these than three digits. So what are the limitations of the pre-play attack? Well, there's the ATC sequence, so the transaction counter sequence. So any transaction with a higher transaction counter invalidates all older CVC codes. So the attack is only possible until the original card is used again for another transaction, which is, unfortunately, with most card issuers, not true, because they don't really care about the sequence of the transaction counter. And the second thing is, our attack is for MaxStripe mode only. So if both the card and the terminal support EMV mode, they would use EMV mode and make it impossible to use this attack, which is the case, for instance, in Europe. But to avoid this problem of EMV mode use, we have the downgrade attack. So the downgrade attack forces the terminal to use a MaxStripe mode transaction, even so the card, the original card, supported EMV mode. So how does this work? Well, the data, the static card data, is not authenticated, it's not integrity protected, so it's possible for the attacker to simply change bits in this static data, and one of these bits of the static card data says if the card supports EMV mode and MaxStripe mode, or only MaxStripe mode. So what we do is we simply change these bits and then in our card clone, and then our card clone says to the terminal, hey, I only support MaxStripe mode, you have to talk MaxStripe with me. So how do we actually mount this attack? We use a standard NFC mobile phone, like this Galaxy Nexus, to pre-play and downgrade the card. So we use the mobile phone to read the static card data and to pre-generate 1,000 CVC codes, which is the number of CVC codes necessary if we have a 3-digit unpredictable number that is sent from the terminal. So for every unpredictable number that can come from the terminal, we have one ready-made CVC code. Yeah, and collecting 1,000 CVC codes with this mobile phone takes only about a minute, so the attack can be done pretty fast if you have short access to a real credit card. Then we have this, the card data and the pre-generated codes on the mobile phone. So we just use a blank smart card. We implemented a Java card applet for the smart card, which has rudimentary data structures of a real credit card. So we can fill these data structures on the card with the static card data. And we also fill the CVC codes into the card. And whenever our fake card receives a transaction from a terminal, it simply looks up which unpredictable number was sent by the terminal and returns the transaction counter and the CVC code for this. So this card, the cloned card, actually responds just like a real credit card. So what are the results? We tested this with this Galaxy Nexus phone. We copied the data from one of these credit cards to our clone, and we then could actually perform a payment transaction at a point of sale terminal with our blank card. And on the side, you see the receipt. So we tested it with 1 cent, and we could actually perform the payment, and the payment receipt says the transaction was approved, So the transaction was actually approved by the card issuer online through the MasterCard backend. We performed this test using 3 different credit cards from 2 different card issuers, and we tested it on 3 different payment terminals, all from the same acquirer, and in all cases, the payments were approved. So what improvements can we make to our attack? There's one thing, on the credit card, the credit card stores the number of digits for the unpredictable number, which means that when you copy the data, you could reduce the range of unpredictable numbers by simply storing another number of digits of the unpredictable number on your copied card. However, this would make the transaction faster, but not all issuers allow this. So the number of digits is actually sent to the card issuer, and one of the 2 card issuers we tested it detects this case and reports the transaction as fraudulent. Another improvement is abusing specific terminal weaknesses. One of the 3 terminals we tested actually implemented the MasterCard specification in quite a strict way. And the MasterCard specification says that if a transaction gets interrupted at any point, the terminal has to restart the transaction and resend a new unpredictable number, which means that we can interrupt the communication with the point of sale terminal after we received the first unpredictable number from the terminal. We then decide we don't have a CVC code for this unpredictable number, so we restart the communication with the terminal, and in the restarted session, the terminal simply sends us a new unpredictable number which differs from the original one, so we have another unpredictable number to test if we have CVC codes. This works with this terminal up to 6 times in a row, so we can reject the first 5 unpredictable numbers and then use the last one. So we can greatly reduce the 1,000 codes to about a fifth of them and hopefully still can make a transaction. So what is the possible workaround for this? Well, there is MasterCard actually implemented measures to prevent this attack scenario, but none of the card issuers did, or none of the card issuers we tested did. So the issuer actually receives the information if the terminal supports EMV mode, and the issuer also receives the information if the transaction was performed using EMV mode or magnetic stripe or MagStripe mode. And also the issuer knows what card they issued, so they know if their card supported EMV mode or only MagStripe mode. So joining these 3 bits of information, the issuer can detect if a card was downgraded from full EMV to only MagStripe mode by matching if a MagStripe transaction was performed at an EMV compatible terminal with a card that supposedly supports EMV mode. Second workaround to reduce or to limit the attack is to prevent the reduction of the number of digits of the unpredictable number. During our tests, we found out that one issuer actually detects the number of digits of the unpredictable number and rejects transactions that use a smaller number or any other number. So the issuer can detect this case, and they should prevent this case. Another workaround is maximizing the number of digits of the unpredictable number. So if you have only a MagStripe card, you still can do the attack because the issuer doesn't know if it was done with the real card or with the cloned card. But if the number of digits of the unpredictable number is incremented only to 4, then it already takes 10 minutes to make a preplay attack, which makes the preplay quite unfeasible, because who wants a mobile phone on his credit card for 10 minutes, or who gives away his credit card for 10 minutes? Most likely nobody. So the issuers should try to maximize the size of the unpredictable number. So, I have a short demo video. Hopefully it works. No. So this shows how we tested the attack. We use credit card. Then we have an app on our mobile phone where we can select that we want to collect a whole range of CVC codes. Then we put the phone on the original credit card, which takes for 1,000 codes about a minute. After this minute, we collected the 1,000 codes, and now we can use our card clone, dummy card, and we, in our app, we say we want to transmit or transfer the data to our card clone. Again, this takes quite a lot of time, and as you saw, I had to replace the card on the mobile phone because NFC doesn't really have a good communication with this card clone card. But then, after copying the codes and the static card data, we use the terminal, perform enter an amount, and perform a transaction. And the payment is approved. So we successfully paid 1 euro cent at our point of sale terminal. This point of sale terminal we used is a point of sale terminal that is actually connected to an acquirer account, so it's a real payment terminal, and the same payment terminal with the same acquirer is also used in several shops in Austria. We did not test our attack in a real shop because we didn't want to get busted for this. Yeah, so okay. So to conclude the presentation, we successfully performed a pre-play attack against the EMV contactless MaxDrive protocol. We extended that attack even to EMV mode by downgrading two max cards to MaxDrive mode. However, we found out that protocols already would contain countermeasures, but that these countermeasures are not used by the issuers we tested, and we expect that most issuers don't do this. We reported our findings to MasterCard and the involved issuers. From the involved issuers, we didn't receive any response. From MasterCard, we received quick response. They acknowledged the vulnerabilities, but pointed out that their protocols and rules provide countermeasures, and that it's left to the card issuers to implement these countermeasures. Yeah.
So you have to forgive my ignorance to the whole back-end payment processing systems, but when you were mentioning the issuer is able to implement some sort of detection or mitigation,
yeah.
Is that, who's the issuer and like what is the process for that? Is it a firmware change to the terminals or is it just something on the complete back-end that they can implement?
The attack is completely independent of the terminal. So the issuer is the bank that issues the credit cards. Or an entity behind the bank that actually issues the credit cards. So they also check when a transaction is performed at the point of sale terminal. They receive an online authorization request and they say this transaction is valid then they authorize the transaction, and the money is actually transferred to the merchant, or they say this card is blocked, or this was not performed with a real credit card, then they deny the transaction. So during the process, the point of sale terminal sends data to the acquirer. The acquirer then forwards this data to the card issuer, and in this data, the information is contained about the terminal and about the used card and the transaction.
Is there any possibility that some of these checks that could be done on the back end are just done under different scenarios, if there's a high risk transaction or it's a greater dollar amount, or is it kind of completely independent of that?
Might be the case. So we tested transaction up to 20 euros, which is pretty much the limit for contactless transactions in Austria, and those transactions worked.
Last question is, what's the max range for this kind of ISO 14444443?
Well, with a mobile phone, touching it. Yeah. With other equipment, it might be possible to perform communication up to a meter or so.
Yeah, I was thinking of your 10-minute example of being, you know, infeasible, but I just sat next to a bunch of people for 20 minutes, and I guess if you had the right hardware that was also concealable in some way, you might be able to pull off a little bit longer range attack.
Yeah.